Hello and welcome to Useful Idiots. I'm your host, one of them, Katie Halper.
And I'm the other one, Matt Taibbi.
We got a great show for you today, and you'll see why, because we're going to be talking to another Matt named Matt Christman. So
right. This is the premiere episode. It's actually the second episode of Between Two Mats. But it's the first time we recognize it as
right,
such.
Yes, we see it. We're holding space for it.
So I guess let's just jump right into the four food groups.
Let's do it. Yeah, we got a lot of great stuff because Biden is the guy. So obviously, always very interesting.
He's a man.
Yeah.
So Democrats suck. Republicans suck. Isn't that terrible? Isn't that weird? Katie, you're up.
Democrats suck. So for Democrats suck, I thought we could talk about reading from The Intercept. Biden defense secretary nominee Lloyd Austin comes under fire, funny pun, for industry connections. So Biden announced he's going to nominate retired four-star General Lloyd Austin III, once the top commander of U.S. forces in the Middle East, and now a member of the board of directors at, say it with me now,
Raytheon.
The company has been in the spotlight during the Trump administration in part because it supplies air-to-ground munitions for Saudi Arabia's war in Yemen, and Austin's role with Raytheon could be central to his confirmation fight. Well, let's certainly hope. And, you know, just continuing, because there's a lot of really good information in this article. He oversaw U.S. operations in the Middle East until March 2016. A year after the Saudi-led intervention began, he retired from the military the next month and later joined the board of United Technologies, a defense contractor that merged with Raytheon earlier this year. In 2019, Raytheon proceeded with an $8 billion arms sale to Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates, which included air-to-ground munitions.
Gee, that all sounds like a felicitous chain of events, doesn't it?
I want this guy. I don't even want him to be...
Military man goes to small company, which is then acquired by a bigger company, which then sells gets billion-dollar contract from the Pentagon. Right. I wonder how all of that ties together.
But at least it's for a good cause.
Right, it's...
Because Saudi Arabia is with Yemen, those
Yemeni kids, if you let them get over 3 feet tall, they can cause all kinds of problems.
Yeah, and if they have a full diet, Yemeni kids tend to get very chubby. It's called the Yemeni chub.
They bite your knees. Yeah.
Wait, they bite your knees? Why?
Well, I mean, because they're small. That's what they, you know, you got to stop them before they get taller.
Oh, you mean they stop at the knee? They can't. You don't want them to bite your thigh or worse.
Right.
Is that what you're saying? I see. Yeah. On their way up, they could bite a lot of bad things.
That's why you got to drop those Raytheon missiles on them.
Yes.
Before they get over like 3 feet tall.
So after congressional Democrats blocked the sale on human rights grounds, the Trump administration helped force the sale through by declaring a state of emergency. So that's great. I guess other contenders, Biden had like a resume pool, I guess, of other people with flagrant and blatant conflicts of interest. So you had Michelle Flournoy, who is the former Undersecretary of Defense for Policy, and she joined the board of Booz Allen Hamilton in 2018.
I love how their response to the criticism of a Booz Allen Hamilton nominee is to get a Raytheon board member.
Yeah, you're right. Yes. Well, and then they are also considering former Homeland Security Secretary under Obama, Jay Johnson, who sits on the board of Lockheed Martin. So they're like, none of this Booz Hamilton, Booz Allen Hamilton. We're not going to name someone from Booz Allen Hamilton. That would be ridiculous. And Lockheed Martin would be obscene. We are bringing you someone from Raytheon, right? But he's African-American, and I look forward to people like, you know, New York Times journalist Jonathan Martin. He's going to, I'm sure, chide anyone who criticizes him like he did with Cedric Richmond, for instance. Yeah. Also, Matt, you know more about this than I do, but like, this is a precedent, right? You're supposed to wait a couple, like the revolving military industrial complex is supposed to be a little more, like, it's supposed to revolve more slowly than it is in this case. So, Austin is slated to face a rocky confirmation process, not only due to his business ties, but also because his nomination already was criticized as a violation of civil-military relations. By law, the Secretary of Defense position is a civilian position and not supposed to be held by recently retired officers. The rule is meant to emphasize civilian control over the military, and Austin has not yet undergone a legally required 7-year cooling-off period. Austin's confirmation will require Congress to waive that requirement, just as they did with Trump's first defense secretary, retired General Mattis. So this is a great example, by the way, of the Democrats doing exactly what the Republicans did. Not just the Republicans did, but this unprecedented existential threat named Donald Trump. Turns out Biden does the same thing.
Well, look, in fairness, this is something that the Democrats have been doing since time immemorial, which is, you know, raising the military budget and putting defense contractors in.
Right.
But not authority.
Right. But isn't the whole thing about Trump is that he violates norms and etiquette, and he violated those with Mattis, and they were upset about that. But now they're doing with this guy. Like, again, they could find a terrible person who had that 7-year cooling off period. Probably.
Yes, that's true. That is true. But, you know, I remember when Barack Obama came into office and he promised that he wasn't going to have any registered lobbyists in his government. And then, like, within 5 minutes, he had a guy named Mark Patterson named as Deputy Secretary of the Treasury. And he was a Goldman lobbyist. So, you know, we might as well just sort of end the pretense that the Pentagon is anything but a way to funnel money to basically five companies.
Right. A lot of people also.
While killing a lot of people. Well, clearly, but I think the problem is that the illusion that the Pentagon exists to defend the country gets in the way of the primary mission of delivering profits to these companies.
Right.
So we might as well just start justifying things like invasions of various countries by saying, you know, we haven't gotten enough money for General Dynamics this year, or for Northrop Grumman, or, you know, Lockheed right. Martin, or whatever it is. So we need to use this weapon system because we've been in the desert too long. We need to invade a country with mountains, you know.
Change it up, switch it up a little
change
bit.
Change it up, have some submarine battles.
Right.
Right?
Truly intersectional warfare.
Intersectional warfare.
In a geographic sense, yep.
Yeah, so I applaud this move.
Yeah.
Anything else on that?
Yeah. Well, there's also the fact that, like, Marsha Fudge, who is an African-American congresswoman from Ohio, whose policy expertise is in agriculture, and she wanted to be Secretary of Agriculture. And last month, she told Politico, we are going to have to stop looking at only certain agencies as those that people like me fit in. You know, it's always, we want to put a Black person in labor or HUD. And guess where Biden named Fudge? Guess which department he
is she going to do it?
Unclear. Yes, I think so. And then we'll talk about that because Nina Turner, I think, is going to run for a seat. But yeah, guess where he names her?
HUD,
right.
Nice.
He's probably like, urban. You'll love it.
What do we got for urban?
Yeah, you love it. It's in its name, yeah. Also, but you know who is going to agriculture is Tom Vilsack. And you know what he's famous for?
I always think of that as, like, never mind. Go ahead. Yeah.
What, Vilsack?
Ball sack of balls.
Oh, ball sack, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know why I didn't figure that one out. Vilsack of balls? Katie, what the hell's wrong with you? Obviously, ball sack, yeah. Tom Vilsack, who is going to be, he's naming him to agriculture, and he's known for, remember this little episode where he fired Shirley Sherrod after Andrew Breitbart, like, did a video about her? Do you remember that?
Oh, I don't remember that.
Under Obama, no. Yeah, it was like right away. Black woman, got rid of her real quick. It was a
but what I remember thing. About Tom Vilsack is that approximately 190% of all pundits have identified him as a dark horse to win the presidency at some point.
Oh, okay.
Do you remember those days?
No, I don't think so.
There were like 9 straight election cycles where people were writing columns about, like, okay, well, the supposed front runners are Dukakis and Tsongas and or you know,
whoever. A lot of Greeks,
but,
huh?
Right, but watch out for Tom Vilsack. That was like a big trope in political journalism for a while.
Yeah. I thought you were going to say
Iowa, you know, as everybody thought.
Former governor. And I thought you were going to say that people keep saying Ballsack. I thought that Ballsack. Was what you were going to say, that pundits kept saying that by accident. But sadly, no.
In that case, it would be a funnier story. You know,
yeah.
Watch out for Ballsack.
Yeah. Ballsack coming to a race near you. Could Ballsack win?
Could be a Ballsack victory. Coming up from behind.
Yeah, yeah. Rearing to the front. Be careful. Look, I know you're not expecting it, but I think a Ballsack could really make it. I think a Ballsack could
Balsack drops into the race.
Yeah, Balsack drops in the race. Balsack could really explode as a candidate.
So that's great. So he's made a progressive choice to HUD, so that's good.
Yeah. So those are my Dem suck. And what about you, Matt? Anything for Republican suck?
Those are good. You know, so my Republican suck is less about like something that they did wrong than I just want to chortle in amusement at what's happening to the Republican Party. So basically, because the entire Trump base is pissed off at the party for not being more aggressive in challenging the election results, they may actually end up losing the Senate majority, which is like one of the funniest things.
That would be great.
So Dan, if you could show the clip of these dudes in Georgia talking about why they may not vote in the upcoming runoffs.
Did you vote, sir, in the presidential election here in Georgia?
I did.
Who did you vote for, if you don't mind me asking?
Greatest president we've ever had, Donald J. Trump.
And he lost.
He didn't lose.
He's going to win.
Are you kidding me?
He ain't going to lose.
Do you plan on voting in the Senate runoffs next month?
I do plan on voting in the Senate runoff.
For a Republican, I take it?
I don't know at this point.
So you might not vote Republican in January?
I don't vote for a party, okay?
Oh.
As far as I'm concerned, the Democrats and Republicans can all go to hell.
You, a Georgia voter, a conservative, a Trump supporter, a Republican, saying they might not vote, I would be freaking out. I would say, oh my God, are we going to lose this to the Democrats?
That's the point. Those two Republican senators need to get their asses out of their office and start thumping on the streets and demanding a real recount, not a fake recount.
How can we contribute to this so they're really angry and they sit
No, that's the whole beauty of it. We don't have to do anything.
I'm afraid that someone's going to intervene and convince them to vote.
This is a spectator sport. It's already, there's it's already settled, the dynamics
right, okay,
here.
Right.
So there's nothing that could possibly happen to interrupt the beauty of this. So either the Republicans make more of a spectacle of themselves by deciding to back this failed coup attempt.
Right.
They're not really going to do. Let's just be clear about that. That's not going to happen. Okay. But let's just say they even pretended to do that a little bit more. That's gonna
alienate other voters.
Lose them votes probably down the line, you know, elsewhere. Or they're going to, you know, make the long play move, which is to, you know, do the right thing and encourage Trump to step down, and then they're gonna lose Georgia.
Like, we could do a mashup of Trump saying it was rigged, saying he lost, and then just show the Georgian senators, Republicans, being silent.
Right.
I just want, you know what I mean? We got to call out the outrage.
Yeah.
But you think you think as long as we let these people just say this?
I'm very Star Trek prime directive about this stuff. Like, I don't want to get involved with the alien civilization. So, but you know, I guess if I cared about the Democrats more, I would probably find this even more amusing, but it is really funny. Like, the Republican Party has done so much to destroy itself over the last four or five election cycles that stuff like this is just sort of infinitely amusing to me.
But I like Warnock a lot, I gotta say.
Yeah.
He had a great line with Kelly Loeffler. He's like, you lied on me and you lied on Jesus.
But look, you can't, that you can't excuse.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't get better. And then she's like, I'm not going to be lectured about Christianity by a pastor who is literally pastoring from the same pulpit as Martin Luther King. Not a good line, I don't think. It's a bit clumsy to go that route.
What was her physical attitude when she said I wasn't going to be lectured? Did she do anything with her head or?
Wait, that's so Matt, don't you know what her physical thing is all the time? Doesn't move.
She doesn't move?
I'm not going to be lectured. This radical liberal. I'm not going to be lectured by a man who uses Christianity to support abortion. My radical
fused vertebrae? Or?
Oh, what if it's an ableist attack? I want her supporters to challenge me. I challenge you guys to call me an ableist for my attacks on Kelly.
And her fused spinal cord.
Yeah. Actually, no, you can't because, wow, I've never used this. Not to weaponize anything, but I had, you know what I had, Matt, when I was 11?
Yeah, you had...
I had scoliosis.
I had spinal fusion.
Yep. So come at me.
Yeah, so you have carte blanche.
I have carte blanche, yeah.
That's an underrated, sort of aspect of the show is that we do get to pick on people who have had spinal fusion issues.
Spinal bifida, totally off limits. Spinal fusion, okay.
Yeah.
You have anything that you want people to, like, that you have license to?
I've had lung surgery, but I don't think that really counts, so.
Lung surgery counts, of course.
Yeah,
okay. In fact, we should find every person we don't like who has had lung surgery
and
tease
them
mercilessly. Mm. That's a good, that'll really win people to our side.
That's the secret weapon. So
how dare you, unilung, one lung.
Instead of aqualung, monolung.
Yeah.
Yeah, excellent. So I don't know. Anyway, it's just, the whole thing is funny to me because the Republicans, ever since Trump came along, they just have not figured out a strategy for how to proceed. Like, there are really only two ways to go. One is to jump whole hog in with the Trump experience and just ride that wave.
Yeah.
And the other is to do what they've been doing, which is to try to retain the infrastructure of the former party and their surface respectability and all that while having Trump voters. And that just doesn't work.
It's hard math, right?
Yeah. It's funny to see that backing up on them. Okay, so what do we got for...
Isn't that terrible? Dan, could we click on the link? And this is a tweet from Mom for Progress, Jenna Stimulus Now, but her handle is Mom for Progress. I'm very grateful to Mom for Progress who suggested this, but she suggested this as an isn't that weird. Now, maybe it should be an isn't that weird, but I thought that I could use it as an isn't that terrible. And she wrote, this is really crazy and gross, and isn't that weird candidate for you. But I'm going to say, isn't that terrible? So Chai Montgomery tweets, Simothea exigua. It enters through a fish's gills, eats the tongue, and then replaces it. This delight sucks out the blood of the fish's tongue and then replaces the withered tongue with itself. Now, every time the fish eats, it takes away a portion of the food for itself. Now, Matt, how would you describe this image?
It looks like a miniature version of the alien.
Yeah, yeah. So in this photo, you see it's like a fish, right? A fish's open mouth.
It's a mouth within a mouth, basically.
And inside this fish's mouth it's almost cute. It would be cute if it hadn't just eaten its tongue, its host's own tongue. It's almost cute. What would you describe that thing in it as?
It looks like a cross between a crab and a mite.
Yeah, it's a crab. It's a mighty crab.
Yeah. And it's got a face.
And eyes.
Yeah. It looks a little bit like a golden retriever, a little bit.
Oh my God, it's Bailey.
Yeah, it's Bailey.
It's got a little Bailey.
If you could imagine like an arachnid version of Bailey.
Yeah, that's what you have.
That's basically what
but
this is.
But it's mini structural Bailey. I mean, it does change the structure of the fish's mouth, so it's actually more transformative than Bailey ever was. But
how can anybody believe in God when something like this exists?
I thought, Matt, I swear we're really rubbing off on each other because I thought you were going to say how awesome this was, but no, it's awful.
That's great. Look, that's a fantastic strategy. Eat something's tongue, replace it, and then take some of the food, but actually still function as a tongue. That's like awesome.
Yeah, it is. I mean, it's kind of moving. I feel like conservatives would use this as a metaphor for a parasite and be anti-parasite. But I want to suggest that this is a beautiful symbiotic socialism in action. I mean, it's probably the worst, literally the worst propaganda for socialism I've ever seen is a disgusting creature eating the tongue of another one. But it is kind of an interesting model. And I want to say this to threaten rich people. If you don't share your wealth, there may or may not be creature that lives in there.
You may end up having a non-college educated person eating inside your mouth.
Yeah, a very little one. A Yemeni. Actually, it'll be a Yemeni tot.
Well, yeah. That is terrible. That is disgusting. All right. Isn't that weird? Dan, can we look at the coronavirus Romania issue? Okay, good headline. It's solid.
Can you read it for people? Yeah.
Romanian cobbler makes size 75 winter boots to stamp out COVID-19. Now, I'm pretty sure they mean the European shoe size there.
I want to give him a shout out for the pun. Stamp yeah. it out.
That's fantastic. All right, so let's just read the lead. Well, how do I pronounce that?
Cluj,
Romania.
Yeah.
A Romanian cobbler who made giant shoes to help keep people apart during the first wave of COVID-19 has come up with a new line of huge winter boots to stamp out the second onslaught of the disease. Grigori Loop said the shoes he launched in May in a European size 75 had sold across the world and helped keep his store afloat in the Transylvanian city of Cluj. He started making them when he noticed people were standing too close together and ignoring social distancing rules. Two people facing each other in his elongated footwear would be forced to stand just under 2 meters apart. How could that be possibly true? In order for that to be true, each shoe would have to be a meter, like almost a meter long.
I guess it would work, especially if you're standing toe to toe. That gives you a lot of distance, but I think that probably isn't that sustainable walking model. You'd have to do it like one person going backwards, one forward.
You could be side by side. You could be on top of each other.
Wait, but side by side, you have to have amazing turnout, which I have.
I think this is it's a cute story, but it's flawed. Like, if you really want to do this, I think you would have to make the shoes circular, right? And they would have to they would essentially have to be stilts.
I got really excited about this story because I thought they were 75 American size, but it's still good. It's still a good. I mean, you can see if you're watching, you see it. It's not normal human shoe size.
No, I'm very in favor of big shoes. I actually owned a pair of clown shoes once.
Why?
Okay, I did a story where I used to get different jobs for stories, and I worked in a clown theater, so they gave me a pair of shoes.
How was that?
I was a pretty bad clown, I have to say. Like, I was.
Do you have any photos of this?
It's in my Excel book. There is a photo, but I was more scary than funny. I think the kids definitely did not find me, fun to hang around with.
So what you should have done is worked in one of those haunted houses that evangelicals create, where you're like AIDS, or what else? What are the punishments for being?
Right. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. Or like the, you know, a teen father or something like that.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Uh-huh.
All right. So that was slightly weird. What else do we have? There was a little bit of a something that you wanted to talk about this week, wasn't there?
So yes. So I wanted to. This could go under isn't that terrible, or isn't MSNBC terrible? It's a short video, and this is with Stephanie Ruhle. Now, some of you may remember Stephanie Ruhle for getting really triggered by Biden's obviously dishonest motto slogan of this race being between Scranton and Park Avenue. Do you remember that?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
She's like, I don't live on Park Avenue, but I live pretty close. And how did she get there? She worked her butt off. So this is Stephanie Ruhle on MSNBC with Bernie Sanders. And shout out to Case Study QB for this. You should follow him on Twitter.
Independent Senator Bernie Sanders from the state of Vermont. He is leading a group of progressive Democratic senators demanding $1,200 stimulus checks be included in the next relief bill. Senator, we've heard your impassioned argument. Help us understand, how many other senators have you convinced to support these stimulus checks? Any Republicans on board?
Yes, I think there is one, but Senator Holly indicates that he is supportive of a $1,200 per person direct payment and $600 or $500 for children. I think the Democratic caucus is ready to go forward on that. Yesterday, I sent out a letter with five other senators, and I think we can have virtually all of the United States Democratic senators on board. The question now is whether or not Mitch McConnell is going to turn his back, as your report just indicated, on the incredible suffering that the American people, the working people, are now experiencing. Unemployment high. We have a record level of hunger in America. Millions of people are facing evictions. This is an emergency. Congress has got to respond aggressively to help working families. You know, Stephanie, I always get a kick Here in Washington, when we go to war, there's endless amounts of money. Tax breaks for billionaires, endless amounts of money. Corporate welfare, endless amounts of money. Where children are going hungry in America today, suddenly we don't have enough money. That's crap. That's wrong. And if we have got to stay here throughout Christmas, which is the last thing in the world that I would want to do, we are going to stay here because we are going to make sure that struggling working families in this country get the help they desperately need.
Okay, watch this part, ready?
Senator, I'm not agreeing with you fundamentally, but I want to talk to you practically. You've been the lead sponsor of 422 bills during your 30 years in Congress, but only 7 of them have become law. Given that record and how dire things are, as you just laid out, do you need to find another lane or take a different approach here?
I don't think that's the issue, Stephanie. I mean, you can ask me how many other senators have passed significant legislation in recent years.
I hope we were recording Matt's response to that. Look at Matt. He's, for listeners only, he's laughing. You can kind of hear it. What are your thoughts on that, Matt?
Oh, man, that is really funny. That's a dump truck full of petty right there, you know?
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, first of all...
Oh, and by the way, sorry, for people just listening, she says that he's only... that he's what sponsored 400 bills, I think, and only 7 of them passed. They have a graphic of it if you're just listening.
It's just unbelievable. It's like, yeah, Bernie, whatever. I get this whole thing about people being hungry, but don't you suck?
Yeah. Like that's and here's the graphic to prove it. Here's the graphic to prove it. Also, you see how she thinks it's a gotcha when she asks him which Republican?
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Also, do you notice she makes a mistake and she says, "I don't fundamentally agree with you, but."
Yeah, she meant that I don't disagree with you.
Right.
Yeah. I hope.
I mean, do you think, what other graphics do you think they have waiting, in the wings for Bernie?
Well, first of all, I think that the news story that's coming is Bernie Sanders owns 3 masks.
That's good. Wait, oh, masks like that. I was like still stuck in clown mode. Right. 3 masks. Yes, that's really good.
And one of them's really on a lake, right?
Yeah, and one of them is on a lake. They should make fake Bernie masks and pretend that they're real and just be like, I have a third house, you bastard. Schmuck. I got 3 houses, you schmuck, and put that on a mask and pretend he's selling them. Yeah.
In all serious notes, the Democrats are so petty about this stuff. And Sanders, and I know this because I did a story about this, and I ended up in this whole controversy that involved the New York Times as well, because they did a report about his record.
Yeah.
And Sanders, for ages, you know, really understood that he was probably not going to get a lot of bills passed, among other things, because he was an independent. And because the kinds of things that he was interested in probably weren't going to get past either his own caucus in the Democrats or the Republicans. So he worked a lot on passing amendments. So, yes. So his specialty was getting bipartisan support, because this is a thing that people probably understand less, you know, outside of Washington, but there are a lot of people who want to vote for certain things because they're right and correct, but they can't because politically there's a cost that would come with it. So, you know, there are a lot of people who don't want to vote down PBS or whatever it is, or don't want to add another $100 billion to the defense budget. But if they actually do that, there's going to be an issue. But people don't pay as much attention to amendments, you know. And so if you have an appropriations bill, like an omnibus appropriations bill, and buried in it somewhere is a provision, you know, that pays for, rural medical, rural health care centers, right? People are less likely to notice something like that, so people will vote for it. Like, in other words, you can get people from across the aisle to vote for things that are amendments as opposed to the whole bill. And nobody passed more roll call amendments than Bernie did over like in a very, very long time. And it is true that it's difficult to get a bill passed. He doesn't have an awesome record on that, but he passes an awful lot of stuff. I watched it happen. So.
Yeah.
That criticism is so petty. It's and to bring it up in that spot is just crazy.
I mean, is it petty? Okay, I was actually talking about this with a friend. Is it that they just hate him so much and he makes their skin crawl, as Mimi Rocha said? Is it that they're actually opposed to him making this radical demand that people get more than $600 a month, which is insane? Like, which do you think it is? Is it a combination? I mean, we know that she's upset about Biden's totally empty, meaningless cliche about Park Avenue versus Scranton. Like, what the hell is he going to do for people in Scranton versus Park Avenue? Nothing. He's just saying that. So, yeah. So what do you think her motive is? Or like the motive of MSNBC in general with that?
Well, I think with this issue, the pandemic relief, the Democrats all along have been motivated by two things. Number one is trying to make sure that the Republicans don't get any
credit
or any kind of political bounce from it. So that's probably why they were slow and, you know, throughout the election year. But from now going forward, the real issue is bigger because they want to avoid the precedent of the government just giving people money. I mean, I think that's something that matters a lot to a lot of their most important donors. And we saw this with the financial crisis response when. Remember, there, you know, even with the TARP, that was an $800 billion program. And then there was a whole galaxy of Fed programs that equaled, you know, somewhere between $5 and $20 trillion, depending on who you asked. There was only a very tiny slice of that that actually went to people who foreclosed in their houses. And that was because people in both parties were very insistent that they not set the precedent of sort of helping people willy-nilly, right? And that's also why every social program that involves any kind of aid has to be means tested to death and everything like that.
Disgusting.
So, you know, this is a big deal for both parties to avoid, you know, to find their way through this thing without having to give that kind of a program. You know,
I think what stands out about it is it seems really, really petty, but it's actually much more profound. I mean, it's like absolutely tacky and just like inappropriate so it's like petty. What does petty mean literally? Like small, is that the origin of it?
I guess, yeah. It's like, you know,
right, exactly.
It's the French word for, you know, comes out of the word petit, right? So it's just small. Yeah,
so it's small, but it's also large, right? Like it is an actual very big deal ideological difference. But it just is so gross the way it's presented. So it comes across as petty.
Well, they've already done a good job of kneecapping Bernie as a viable threat to take over the party. And so that's done.
So this is a dick move, a petty dick move.
No, but I think there's an important moment here where they can't allow him to suddenly start being they can't allow him to be the voice crying in the wilderness and, you know, trying to be the conscience of the Democrats and giving them a hard time about stuff all the time. That's got to be a non-starter. They can't have that happening from the beginning of the Biden administration. So, you know.
Right. They need to undermine any attempt to actually move Biden to the left or actually just towards helping people. They can't let this precedent happen. So they have to. I mean, it's just, it's so gross. It's so gross.
Especially when you think about it in terms of how much money is coming out of the Fed right now to prop up the financial markets. You know, they basically said, we do not care how much money it costs. The Fed chair says things like, we're not going to run out of ammunition, which basically means we will spend as much as it takes. So that's what it looks like over on that side. But on this side, they're haggling over relatively small amounts of money.
The other thing is that, like, this is people, we've talked about this before, the pseudo technocratic argument, right? Like, they're pretending this is a pragmatism thing. And they're also, people love pretending that the only reason you should fight for something is if it's definitely going to get passed, as if major legislation in the past hasn't failed before it got passed, or as if you don't build the case or shift, sorry, trigger warning, the Overton window when you demand things. So like, whether or not, like, God forbid you're actually making the case that this is not enough money and it doesn't get passed, right? It's not built into the stimulus package. Like, good. Like, that's better than not making the case. But they really don't want it to be made.
Right. Also, remember, there's a political benefit in forcing people to take a position on things, too.
Yeah, of course. So, yes.
So that's part of what you... That's part of how you build it for passage, you know, down the road, is you make sure that, you know, if people vote against it, maybe their constituents don't like that.
Yeah, and then you get to point to that and say, this person voted against this. And then that becomes a toxic position. And then you get the Democrats can then say, this party is voting against this. And then,
This has been central to how this new version of it's not even new anymore, the sort of Clintonian version of the Democratic Party, how they've understood legislating since the very beginning. They've always talked about like how transactional politics over purity politics. So you have to focus on what transaction is possible at the moment.
Right.
And they, you know, and that's even in a situation like this where you can make the case for any amount of money, given the emergency that we're in, they won't do it.
Yeah.
So that is a funny clip, but you're right. It's a more serious issue.
No,
that, so.
I mean, it is. You got to laugh instead of cry. I wasn't pushing back on like, you're not taking it seriously enough. I was just like, yeah, it's disgusting.
Craziness. So
we'll get a raise at MSNBC.
Yeah. All right. We're going to talk to our guest.
Yes.
Whose name is also Matt.
Yeah.
And, and he, is one of the hosts of Chapo Trap House.
And his own vlog, Kush Vlog.
Smart guy. Like one of the things about
very
him,
smart. And very
every
funny,
time
yeah.
I read him on Twitter, I think, wow, his brain is more fertile than mine is. Like he comes up with a lot of stuff that's just like super interesting.
Yeah, he really is one of the voices of our generation. I mean, I'm not even being sarcastic. He really is. Like his takes are always really good.
Absolutely. So we're gonna talk to him now, and it should be a good conversation.
Yeah, it'll be great. So excited to have on Useful Idiots, none other than Matt Christman, host of one of the hosts of Chapo Trap House, and also of his own Kush Vlog, which is a great YouTube show. Welcome.
Thank you.
What's our record on Chapo people at this point?
Only two.
This makes two, right?
Yeah, this makes two. Yeah, okay. Sounds like a sitcom. Yeah. Or this could be Between Two Matts also.
Right,
like between two ferns, yeah.
I like that.
Mats, yeah,
I
yeah.
Like
we
that.
Should have swapping out mats.
Actually, it is. It's kind of a like a reverse Three's Company kind of a situation.
Yeah, yeah. Let me just trip over my couch and then we're perfect. We're good to go. Yeah, Matt, thank you so much for coming on. I wanted to ask you about this recent vlog you did where you spoke about a major cultural divide between Republicans and Democrats in college and non-college, and then the motto of don't be a P-U-S-S-Y and the motto of the don't be a N-A-S-S-H-O-L-E. I don't know why I'm spelling them out, maybe because it'll so we don't get in trouble with YouTube. Anyway, can you talk about those two mantras and what they mean?
Well, the first thing is that it's not really about whether you went to college or not. There's a lot of Republicans, and basically everybody at the top of the Republican heap went to college.
Of course, yeah.
It's that it's about a package of values that you subscribe to. If you went to college, to some percentage point of agreement, you get assimilated into an idea of this is the world. This is how you make it in the world. This is what the good is. And everyone, Republican or Democrat, comes out of the college experience basically in agreement in large groups, you know, at the demographic level that, you know, the world is messed up, but it can't really be changed in any fundamental way. All you can do is seek to succeed for yourself, for your family, and forever a larger group that you have some sort of emotional affinity with. And that is where the values kind of break down. Republicans sort of stop at, I'm going to succeed any way I can, and any distribution of resources that comes out of everyone competing together and using their various skills to try to get ahead, whatever distribution comes out of that is essentially fair, because it is a reward. It's the reward or punishment based on your ability to thrive, which is your virtue, basically. And then the Democrat liberal view, which comes with a more intense acculturation around specific like college based conceptions, says, yes, succeed and by your own virtue, but there are other roadblocks to success that mean that a pure distribution of resources depending on ability within the market is unfair because of the roadblocks that certain people have based on their demographics, and that we should order society in a way to correct for those. But the thing that they share is a bedrock assumption that capitalism is inviable, and that virtue comes from success, comes from thriving in the marketplace. And you, the reason people go to college is to find out how to go about doing that. But now we're getting a situation where the democratic version, the more fully articulated version of that, is now a culturally hegemonic force that people encounter, not just if they go to college, but if they don't go to college, through popular culture, which is universally created by and for people who did. And as the conditions in this country deteriorate, and as the system proves incapable of addressing it, and most importantly, as politics and culture come closer together and in fact become inextricable, and politics becomes culture and vice versa, people are going to find themselves who otherwise, as part of their not having gone to college experience, kind of checking out on politics in general, making a frankly rational decision to just kind of ignore that stuff because it doesn't actually affect their lives, which, correct, it doesn't really, are going to enter into the political arena, and they are going to be confronted with these two visions of politics, which boil down to your virtue is dependent upon your acculturation towards a collection of manners and etiquette, which are presented as morality, but in practice are simply a ruling class, the habits of a civilized ruling class. And if you're not invested in those tropes, if you haven't gone through the conditioning and come out accepting it, you over time, I think, are going to find more and more people who didn't go to college, even if, you know, the non-college team, the Republicans, are as committed to their immiseration as the Democrats are, finding a cultural affinity for a project that rejects manners, because there is no benefit to be had if you didn't go to college from actually paying attention to those manners, because you, by virtue of the fact that you don't have the training, like the specific training in how to move through, you know, the knowledge economy in a way to gain success in it, it holds no benefit to you, whereas the benefit of the non-college, don't be a P-word, Republican Party, at least offers a resentment-filled pleasure in transgression. It allows like a political id to be cultivated, as opposed to the Democrats, which insist upon this superego repression at all points. But that's based on the assumption that doing that gets you something. And more people realize it doesn't actually get them anything.
That's really interesting, because this is something that Greenwald says a lot, which is that, especially with Democrats, everything is about culture. Like, issues are completely secondary. So they have a cultural affinity for people like Bill Kristol, and Max Boot, and Jennifer Rubin, because they're the same kind of people as, yeah, you know, Nancy Pelosi, whereas they are less likely to, to listen to somebody who's poor, but, superficially has, more left-leaning politics than those people. Do you think that's the case, or?
I think the main thing that I try to stress is that this is a symmetrical process. Like everything that a lot of people who are horrified by the stagnification and like this philistinism and this like cultural shibboleth mongering on among liberals and the left broadly, it's the exact same thing on the right. It's just you're seeing it from the outside. you're watching it from the outside, assuming, oh, they're not like that over there. They're not as superficial, and they're not as fixated on maintaining their status hierarchies, and they're not as petty. No, they're exactly as petty, because politics is, for anybody who is participating in it at the level of the discourse, like politically, either professionally or because they're seeking a professional entree, or even they just want some personal clout to make their day more, satisfying than it otherwise would be, that those entrepreneurial incentives are universal. And that because politics is fully detached from any economic questions, there can be no pressure from like reality to change those relationships. I mean, we're seeing right now with the response to COVID, where both parties are in agreement that we are going to wait for a vaccine and hope that solves the demand question that we have in the economy right now, rather than just give people money and set the precedent that you can just give people money. And that is a bipartisan consensus. Neither party has any interest in breaking that. There is nothing in the grassroots or among the political commentariat on either side that can change that either. And as such, all that's left is for everybody to make it hay while the sun shines for themselves, however they conceive that to be, whatever it means to get ahead, to get heard, to get people to pay attention to you, to be validated by others. That's the only game, because the question that politics is supposed to answer, how to make lives better for people, is off the table.
So what you're saying, one of the things that's interesting about it is that that's kind of a taboo subject in mainstream media, right? This idea of a divide between college-educated and non-college-educated people, it's been resisted in like the punditry world to even suggest that there's that kind of a divide going on in America. Like, why do you think that is?
There's a couple of reasons. One of the big ones, honestly, is just, and this is another just universal phenomenon that is very difficult to correct for, which is that people have an inherent immoral investment in these terms. And so when you say something like, the language of a collegiate liberalism or leftism is in some way untranslatable to someone who hasn't had that specific cultural experience, that comes with the assumption from person who hears that, who went to college, that you're a bad person because you did go to college. You are a reactionary because you went to college. You should be lined up and shot because of that. Because that's how we divide people into the good people and the bad people. Like, that's the job of politics, is to create a basket full of deplorables and a basket full of virtuous people, and make sure that you are on top of the basket of good people. And that's, once I said, the Republicans do the exact same thing, reactionaries do the exact same thing. And as such, when you say, like, there's a disconnect here that has to be in some way addressed, because if you don't address it, you will never be able to cross over to make politics real again. There is a assumed judgment, and the problem, and it's compounded by the fact that a lot of people who make that point make it a moral point and try to emphasize, actually, you are a bad person because you went to college, you are a latte sipper or whatever. And then people have a natural response and try to resist that. And so that's a big part of it, is that there's this moral wash that's over all of the terminology and all the questions of politics that we're trying to resolve, that makes it much, much harder to get at real questions of, how this stuff functions, because everyone is defending their own personal virtue. And then there's the other fact that if it is true, it means that a lot of the stuff that's being said and a lot of the work that's being done is a waste of time, and nobody wants to admit that.
What's interesting is that, people who listen to you are so used to people with your politics, my politics, framing things as left versus liberal. So I was kind of surprised and intrigued by the part of this show, this vlog episode, where you talk about how, like, you are largely, or writ large, you are in the Democrat camp, and leftists are in the Democrat camp. Can you talk about that? What defines that, and how it kind of the relationship between within that left camp, I guess, the left liberal divide?
Well, left and liberal share the leftists and liberals share cultural assumptions about the value of cosmopolitanism, the need for for things like racial and gender oppression to be addressed. And I don't think that the fact that liberals believe that invalidates those claims and invalidates that right. politics. But that's hard for people to process because, you know, the left liberal divide is just another recreation of the same question of sorting that goes on between liberals and the right, the left and the right more broadly. Once you've decided who the bad Republicans are and who the bad conservatives are, and you're inside the tent trying to talk, once again, now you have to divide the bad liberals from the good leftists or vice versa. And that requires you to create, to insist upon the existence of these incommensurate political projects. But they aren't fully incommensurate. There are shared values there that need to be, I think, in some way, accepted. The thing that a lot of even leftists can't really accept, though, is that the presiding models for addressing those issues are insufficient and actually can't work, and in many cases are counterproductive. And that is scary because it leads some people to the conclusion, well, then let's just throw that stuff away completely. Let's just go over to the right and get those guys on board with some sort of economic populism. But the Republican Party is as captured as the Democrats are by capital. There is as little grassroots influence on Republican policymaking as there is on the Democrats, which means they're not going to get anything by saying, hey, we're going to sacrifice all that multicultural stuff for some Herrenvolk democracy. That's going to get you a job as a court jester for Tucker Carlson or something, because you don't have any more power in that structure than you do within the Democratic structure. And for me, this is what I think makes people anxious the most when I try to emphasize this stuff, is that the implication for me is that if there is going to be a actual effective left in this country, it is not going to be an outgrowth of any existing political project. It is going to have to come from the actual experience of actual working people in this country, whether they went to college or not. Not saying that if you went to college, sit down, you can't do anything. It is that if anyone's going to do anything, it's not going to be at the level of rhetoric. It's not going to be the level of political organizing or party politics within the Democratic Party or the Republican Party. It is going to be workplace organization of people who bring maybe some of the stuff they've learned from encountering politics in school or online or with friends in conversations to their lives, but applying it to specific questions. Specific workplace questions that will then acculturate and combine into a movement, or it won't. But if there's going to be hope, that's it. And that is scary because it means that a lot of the stuff that people have deeply invested emotionally in and professionally in, because they think they're part of a project that has some sort of horizon of human liberation within it, is essentially a sterile spectacle.
Does that include the Sanders movement? I mean, the conceit of the Bernie Sanders runs in 2016 and 2020 was kind of the opposite of what you're saying, right? Like, in other words, we actually think that within the structure that that we mostly disagree with on a lot of issues, we're going to be able to affect change in some concrete way. But it turned out to be exactly the opposite.
That's the thing, is that this is the problem with and this is a problem that is part and parcel of being a online human, be trying to do politics in the era of a receipts, is that it's almost impossible for you to revise and shape and change your position as facts accumulate, because you have a record of saying something else. And you have to defend yourself as someone who knows what they're talking about. And if you admit you were wrong in the past, that implies you might be wrong now. And no one can do that. But I think that the Bernie campaign was what was around. And it was absolutely the only thing, the only game in town. And it needed to be supported. And I honestly think, even though it was a failure, and more broadly, I think looking back, the premise of it was wrong. The premise that you could kickstart some sort of political consciousness from the top of the political and media heights is wrong. But the residue of it, I think, might be useful. The residue of it at the level of people who participated in those campaigns, who learned things from those campaigns, who made connections from those campaigns, will be some part of the DNA of anything that comes later. I think a lot of people who are embittered by the failure of Sanders want to blame somebody for it. They want to say someone betrayed us. Some faction within the party, they made within the movement, they had the wrong agenda. They were too ID Paul, or they were too class reductionist.
Right. They didn't go hard enough on the media.
It wouldn't have mattered. Right. It would not have mattered to beat the party and to beat the media, which Bernie needed to do. He needed to get people who are not paying attention to politics to care and to think that politics could make their life different. And there was no mechanism to do that. They might have done better with spending some of that money that they had on organizers talking to people, you know, in their hometowns and people they know, instead of on ads, which were basically a complete waste of money. But even then, you know, the scale of the issue, the scale of the problem, and the how far behind we are culturally and socially from having a non-professional conception of politics in this country, means that they were so far behind the eight ball, it probably was doomed regardless. And that's why I really am not interested in litigating any of the questions of like what the strategy was. I think the more important question is stepping back, acknowledging the broad trends that sort of determined these outcomes, and then figure, well, okay, what are the implications of those? And for me, the implication is that, yes, these models, the Democratic Party, the cultural war that we engage in instead of having politics, is sterile, is a dead end, and that real politics is going to have to come from the same place it came from in the first Gilded Age of the labor movement.
I'm trying to take off my Bernie goggles, through which I clearly see the world. But I do think there was, it's more than residue. I mean, I think that he did, and again, I think he made mistakes. I think, you know, conceding without certain conditions was a bad idea. You know, he is, I'm more and more able to not see him as an infallible saint. I mean, I still come, wow. It's not easy. You got to constantly check yourself. I'm always checking my Bernie. Seriously, but I do think that, you know, there are a couple things that his campaign did. One is, like, you know, it injected certain ideas into the mainstream. It showed that these ideas that are so often portrayed by political and media elites as radical are totally mainstream. It also exposed a lot of terrible stuff about the DNC, a lot of terrible stuff about the media. I think the outrage, like balancing Donald Trump outrage with Bernie Sanders outrage, was a very helpful thing to see. And I think, I mean, again.
Oh, I agree. That's the thing is, I agree completely. Like, yeah. Anyone needs to condemn anyone or any decisions that went into this. The structural impediments are such that that any kind of success was always the least likely outcome. And then, you know, reality proved, oh yeah, you know, that's usually what the thing that's most likely to happen is the thing that usually happens. But the goal should be, as you said, identifying those positive results, those things that did seem to change our understanding of politics, and then to move forward with them. That's the important thing.
The best ad he ever did was not an ad he paid for, which was that gif of him walking around Wall Street.
Oh, God.
And a UPS guy just like taps him on the shoulder.
Every time I see that. I remember the first time I watched that, I teared up.
Yeah.
You talk about residue. I mean, I always felt like the Sanders movement kind of grew out of the residue of Occupy a little bit, right? Like Occupy kind of left something in the ether that was there to develop and turned into the Sanders movement. But, you know, what kind of residue is left after the experience of these last two campaigns? I mean, there's a lot of bitterness, I think, and it reminds me a lot of what was going on in the Republican Party before 2016, where suddenly, you started to meet all these people who were, they were like nihilistic, right? They just no longer believed that there was going to be any outcome for them that, you know, from their vote that was going to be positive. So they, you know, they turned to Trump really because just for the shits and giggles, basically. Yeah, but, is that going to be a temptation of people on the other side now, because they're going to feel like, well, what's the point?
If they do, but I think they'll be more likely to just drop out of the political process, because like a lot of those I was talking about how broadly, if you went to college and you've absorbed like the idea that you should be a political subject, you're either a Democrat or Republican broadly. Also, a lot of those Democrats don't vote, but they don't vote like as a point. They don't vote to make a point about voting. And I think that they'd be more likely to do that than to pick some, you know, nihilistic joke candidate, just because the structure of like the broader left politically doesn't really lend itself to the emergence of a figure like Trump. So they'll be more likely to just tune out.
So what do you see on the horizon that is, you know, a potential type of organization or movement that could be the beginning of what you're talking about?
I try, especially after the election and after spending like 4 years in this, you know, in Schrodinger's box, trying to know whether I'm dead or not, or the cat is dead. I'm very happy to sort of.
Did you suck off the cat?
I sucked off the cat in the box. Yes. Or did I?
Exactly. It depends on whether or not we were observing. Right.
Exactly. Yeah. And I'm now happy to swear off predictions in general, done predicting stuff. I'll leave that to Virgil. He likes it. I hate it because I never feel confident. And my track record shows I shouldn't feel confident. but in broad strokes, I think that if there's going to be anything that's going to emerge to challenge the coming, essentially I see the American like political economy as going in these cyclical intensifications of austerity and social liquefaction. Like the first big one was the 1970s realignment, and then NAFTA, then 2008 was huge, and now COVID, a mere not even the 10 years later, is doing it again. But we're now in the middle of another intensification of that process. If anything will emerge to challenge it and change this trajectory, I don't think it's going to be a third party. And I know that is something that realistic leftists have been allergic to for a long time, on good reason, because, you know, our system is designed to adhere to maintain a two-party structure. But I feel like the moment that we have, where we have a politics that is no longer functional, a politics that cannot be contained by the constitutional order, due to a bipartisan refusal to acknowledge the fundamental driver of conflict socially, is very similar to the situation we saw in the 1850s over slavery, the Democrats, if there's hope, the Democrats are going to go the way of the Whigs. And obviously that sounds, you know, unlikely, and it is unlikely, but if we're talking about projecting the future, we're always imagining, you know, we're always having to gather our light around unlikely outcomes, because if you want to be realistic in your projections, you just say, oh no, techno-feudal nightmare forever, an app-based boot on your face for eternity. Like, that's the easy thing to say. So, you know, put myself out there a little bit. If it's going to come from anything, it is going to be a movement that emerges outside of our broken cultural conflict, and that is essentially immune to it, that cannot be co-opted by these stupid arguments that inherently that destroy solidarity, because it will be emerging from people addressing conditions in their lives, not addressing theoretical political questions that tie to their sense of identity and virtue as people.
Do you think that there's value? I mean, yeah, it seems like there's this is the first time in my life, not to do exactly what you said, which is kind of reflect on my own thoughts about this and theories, but This is the first time in my life where I'm really like, no, there does need to be a third party that we get behind, if only to kind of threaten, or we have to actually get started now, but if only to threaten the Democrats to actually do anything to shift left. I mean, to get them to do anything. You know, they have no people on the left. They know that we have nowhere to go.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
But there can be no moving the Democrats anywhere.
Yeah.
There can be no withholding of votes. There could be no coordinate. If you could coordinate to push the Democrats anywhere, Bernie Sanders would be the nominee.
Right.
Yeah. And he'd be president. And and instead, Biden is going to be president. And they have made the transition period a grand display of their indifference and hostility and domination of the left. And there's nothing within this system that can challenge that. There is no amount of local primary runs that can be supported that could have the cumulative effect of changing the calculus of the people at the top of the Democratic Party.
Yeah, there's this Lawrence O'Donnell clip where he's like, I worked on the Hill. We did not care about what the left said because they had nowhere to go.
They're going to go.
Yeah.
There has to be somewhere to go. And the thing is, that requires risk, and that requires maybe letting Republicans win an election sometime because you split the vote. And that kind of thing can only happen if the people doing it don't care about that stuff. If they cannot be neutralized and co-opted by the rhetoric of and the incentive system of the Democratic Party and the media apparatus around it.
What about just mere self-preservation? Even if they don't have any actual pressure that they have to worry about institutionally, isn't there a moment at which either the Republican or Democrat parties have to start thinking, well, we got to start doing something to improve people's lives generally, or else this whole thing is going to fall apart? Do you think there's a possibility that some kind of, you know, institutional urge to self-preservation will kick in? Because it's reaching some breaking points in places.
I think it might, but it'll take the form of, once again, bipartisan, barest possible outcome. Look at the negotiation over the COVID relief. What is the minimum that we can do? And they will keep doing that, and we will keep, even as things get worse, even as social atomization increases, even as, you know, crime goes up and deaths of despair go up, and as long as people are still contributing economically, are still largely being coerced by the market to continue putting in and taking out the inputs and moving the capital around from the demand side as they need to, that they will continue to do that. And the one thing they can't do is have one of the two parties decide to try to leverage actual economic demands, because that destabilizes the whole structure. And the thing is that there's no need to do that, because the Republicans have built-in institutional guarantees that assure that they will never really be out of power, and the Democrats don't need to be in power. They can lose every election, and the people who make up the party at its core points will still be where they want to be, and they know that any system where they're no longer the bagman basically between capital and the political system is one where they are in some inferior position that they don't want to be in.
Yeah, it's, what is it, the rule of iron?
The iron law of institutions, yeah.
Yes.
Switching gears, I know this is a completely different subject, but I wanted to ask about this. So
Biden sucking off his dog.
No, I do want to ask about that. You for our listeners, Matt tweeted about Biden sucking off Major, his dog, right?
Yeah.
Which I think we all agree is what happened.
Yeah.
So when Chapo came on the scene in the last election cycle, there was this extraordinary pushback from legacy media organizations. And I think we all remember some of those articles where they were saying things like, oh my God, they're actually making money. And, you know, they would list the amounts, like, you know, how can we allow this type of thing?
Yeah, Patreon.
Right. So in the intervening 4 years, you know, the model that you kind of established has created all this new media all over the place. And it's had a major effect, I think, on the entire media landscape. How do you see that the how the media looks now versus how it was when you guys first came on the scene, because in, both in terms of where traditional media is and how much people believe in them and what's gone on in alternative media.
Well, there's certainly a lot more alternative media institutions that came in the wake of the 2016 election, and they are creating alternative models for funding. You know, like the crowdfunding model is now, like, everyone understands now at this point that if you want to do any kind of media, political media work, you kind of have to at some level depend on contributions from listeners or viewers, because there is no architecture within the corporate media to allow for anything other than the most vapid identity stuff or just DNC cheerleading. And so that is, it's heartening in the sense that it gives people a potential exposure to alternative points of view. But if the real problem, though, the persisting problem is that if this pool of people who are consuming political media is fixed as it is now within this realm of sort of overeducated younger people, that their, you know, disparate lived experiences and inability to direct any of the things they might be exposed to into their daily, like, working lives, it means that its actual efficacy in the world, which is, you know, what presumably we're doing this for, is pretty attenuated.
Patreon was around before you guys.
Yeah, it was mostly for people drawing nude anime characters.
Yeah. I mean,
why didn't you do that?
Yeah,
so I can't draw the hands. I can't draw the hands.
Yeah, that's the one part. But you guys, I mean, you guys blew it up, put it on the map because you made, you know, you did so well on it. I'm just curious, did you have a conversation? Do you remember the aha moment? You're like, oh, we should do this. We should set up a Patreon.
It was very early on in the thing. I mean, we did our first episodes. They were very haphazard. We didn't really edit them. They just got pulled off of our Google Hangout YouTube link, and they sounded very bad, but people immediately started listening to them. And it was like a couple months. We both were all aware of Patreon as a model. And we thought maybe we could, you know, see what happens, sort of throw it out there. And I was the one who actually set up the Patreon, and I was intensely nervous the whole day. I kind of had to work myself up to doing it because I was just terrified of doing it and then announcing it and then getting nothing. Just like going there like 3 days later and seeing like, you know, $20 or something and wanting to jump off of a bridge. And that didn't happen. But it was completely nothing that we had expected to happen. None of us thought that this was going to be like a career for us or like a new media model. We were just trying to, you know, get like a little extra money, I guess, and just like a little, I guess, just a tangible reflection of interest. Cause you know, those extra Twitter followers you get, you know, that's nice, but you can't buy a pizza with them.
Right.
But yeah, and that's why, and almost immediately we were accused of being, you know, a operation of intelligence, and that we were getting money from, you know, front companies, and it was all a scam. And I fully understand the impulse to think that because of how ridiculously fast everything happened. And the idea that you could create a media like imprint that quickly and that profoundly, it really was, there weren't a lot of other examples of that. So I can see a lot of people had suspicions.
But you also got the Katie Halper show bump.
That was huge. Yes. Huge, yeah. The Katie Halper bump that was really the, even more than when we, cause I started the Patreon at the beginning of summer of 2016 and it was doing well, you know, it was like, I don't remember, but it was, you know, in the thousands. And then you had us out to New York. I went out to New York. I was living in Cincinnati at the time. Felix and Will were living in New York, and we did your show at Brooklyn Commons.
Yeah.
And it was when I went there to do the show, and the whole room was full. That was the moment where I, even more than the Patreon thing, where I had kind of a, I had to sort of stop and realize, oh, my life is different now.
Yeah, you should give me a 1% or something, probably. We'll work it out after the show.
I'll see you in court, but yes.
Yeah, I'll see you in court, yeah. No, but Taibbi, just so you know, Matt Taibbi, the first time they were all together in person to record was on one of my live shows, yeah.
Excellent. Yeah.
So when they write the history of Chapo.
Yeah, you should
get 100%.
You should get a
stake. No, I'm fine with 1%. You don't have to give me 100%, yeah.
Oh, thank you.
I'm assuming there was a direct correlation between getting criticized in legacy media and how much of a bump you got on Patreon. Like in other words, the more they dumped on you, the more money you made. It had to be like that, right?
That was helpful. Yes, that was a big part of it. And then even there was the meta criticisms, like within the Twitter sphere in general. Like we were featured in the New Yorker right after the election, and that ended up being a huge bump, less because of the article, I think, than the people who got insanely pissed at the article and just couldn't stop talking about it.
Yeah, and then there was the bend the knee quote. What was that? What was that in?
Oh yeah, Jeet here wrote about that in the New Republic, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I got a quote from
Will
Menaker, yeah. Which was, of course, translated into some kind of homophobe. I mean, we should do this. We should like play a game where we take something that's not actually problematic and see how many words it takes to. Or just how I could do it really quickly, I think, but how to problematize it and pretend that it's something problematic and offensive. But also, I wanted to know also what you thought about Biden's pick so far, which is your favorite of all of them. I mean to stop the media discussion. Matt,
as a poster, you got to give it up for putting Neera in there.
Do you think Biden is trolling or serious?
Oh, I don't think he's trolling. The idea that it was a message to anybody, this is a small incestuous circle of professional psychopaths, like looking at each other's business cards like Patrick Bateman. And it's all about, you know, who you know,
silly
who you
want to
keep inside the pen and who you want to keep an eye on. And, you know, Neera is somebody who knows where the bodies are buried, literally and figuratively, and you want to keep her happy. So it totally makes sense. Although it would be hilarious if she ends up being the sacrificial lamb who doesn't get confirmed.
Right, right.
Because of her tweets.
Part of me thinks that either she or Rahm Emanuel are sacrificial lambs and distractions because they're both so incredibly odious and over the top. And there are so many people who have their terrible political positions and record who aren't who haven't punched an employee in the chest.
Yeah.
there's some resumes you could have picked from that didn't involve physical abuse or didn't involve putting a decomposing fish on someone's doorstep. Which is, of course, what Rahm Emanuel did and didn't involve covering up.
Did he do that?
Oh, yeah.
I've never heard that.
Yeah.
That story.
No, yeah. So part of me thinks that is a distraction. But, you know, I got to say, and we have to reframe this because the whole narrative of she tweeted things that upset Republicans, that's not the issue, obviously. She's also tried to advocate it. She also advocated for stealing Libya's oil after we overthrew the government there.
Yes.
And using that as this is Ruskian. Maybe this was inspired by Dean Rusk, but it was an actual model, right? Of we need to justify engaging in the world, i.e. Bombing other countries or overthrowing other countries. And if we do it in a way that provides a beneficial outcome, then we can get people on board because most Americans don't want us to be doing that.
She was trying to synthesize Trumpism before its time.
She was
accepting, well, we're going to be everywhere. We have to have our empire's footprint cannot be reduced. And the one of the costs of having an empire that is based on military force is that you underinvest domestically. We have to do what the old the French Republic and Napoleon did, which is have the army feed itself, basically.
Right, right. You know, she's short, as she herself mentions frequently. So maybe she has a Napoleonic complex.
I'm sure.
Just tying it all together, yeah. But yeah, and then we should also give her a shout out for telling basically the Clinton campaign not to push for 15 an hour. advocating for cutting entitlements and lying about it. And I got to say, one thing that's been driving me crazy is they keep talking about her lived experience. I don't know if you've seen this, but it's definitely a talking point. You have Mimi Hirono talking about it. You have journalists talking about it. You have people tweeting about it. And lived experience can be great, but it can also be the worst thing ever if you are advocating cutting the very programs that you benefited from. Like, they talk about she grew up in Section 8 housing, which is, I mean, that's great if she then grew up to advocate for things like Section 8 housing instead of advocate for cutting things like that.
Yeah, well, that's the bipartisan consensus I was talking about. I mean, it's not necessarily that she wouldn't say, I'm not cutting it to punish people. I'm not cutting it because they don't deserve it. I'm cutting it because we can't afford it anymore.
Right, right.
And like, yeah. Well, if you can't have to deal with that, if you can't rely on Section 8, then you need to, as a person, your responsibility is to do whatever it takes to be successful enough in the market to avoid immiseration. And if you can't, if it's due to race or gender, we'll have specific programs to alleviate that. But if once beyond that, it's up to you. And any failures at that point are personal failures, because laundered of all of the moral justifications for liberalism or conservatism broadly is a fundamental belief that that the undeserving, to some degree or another, the poor will always be with us in like the most cynical sense. Like the Republicans say that the poor will always be with us because they're just not able to hack it. There's something inferior about their character or intellect that prevents them from succeeding. The liberals say, well, that's not true for traditionally oppressed poor people, but it basically is true for white poor people.
Right.
In fact, it is their very racism and their social reactionary-ism that prevents them from succeeding, and that there's only so much you can do or should do for people who can't help themselves. And that is the undergirding ideology of both parties.
Right. Which, of course, also does not even help those traditionally marginalized communities, because it's stigmatizing when you don't
have
universal programs.
Well, what it does is it makes the Democratic elites feel less bad about being elites. That's all it's meant to do. It's to launder their guilt. It's to make them feel that they deserve their granite countertops and their townhouse because they know deep down they don't deserve it.
Yeah.
Unlike the heathen in the McMansion, the Republican voter who thinks that he has his wealth by God's grace, I know that it's privilege.
Right.
I'm not giving it up.
Yeah, I'm not doing anything about it. Yeah.
But I deserve it, and he doesn't. Yeah. That's what politics is there to do. And vice versa, the voter, he can look superior to the coastal elite liberal because he believes in God, which he absolutely does not. His God is a in-ground pool and an ATV. Like, that's God, but that fake spirituality is enough to make him worthy of his wealth and others unworthy.
I mean, yeah. It's kind of like the political version of the difference between Catholicism and Protestantism, right? Like, Catholics feel guilty, Protestants don't. Right.
No, that's absolutely it. Yeah. And like the like American like evangelical conservatism is like the end state of American Protestantism.
Right.
Where like, well, because we cannot find God's will in our social lives. We cannot find God's will amongst our fellow man because we don't know them. We only know each other as consumers and as employers and employees, as strangers. So God's will can only be discerned by the distribution of fortune among stuff. People. Mm-hmm. Who's got the stuff?
Right.
And the cat the liberalism is just that guilty conscience, that guilty Catholic conscience that gnaws at your acceptance. And that's why there's so much energy. If the Trump, if Trumpism is like redefining the Republican Party in its cultural values and language, which I think it is doing, and it's irreversible, that's appealing, because who doesn't want to just have fun? Who doesn't want to just, if the ship's going down, why not grab everything you can and have as much fun in the moment as you can? What good is feeling guilty? Unless you've instilled in yourself through acculturation, through the college experience, and then living in the social milieu that comes after that, that there is a real virtue and that there's something to really enjoy. There's something that essentially Democrats get off on not getting off.
Right. Yeah. No, they're
you have to have, you have to have that. You have to have a special experience where that is in any way satisfying. And
is that
you, and it's very difficult to do if you don't have money.
Is that like being an edgelord or something? I don't know what that means.
It's that superego denial. You're denying yourself, and in denying yourself, you express your virtue, right. And therefore you can enjoy the things that you do enjoy. It launders your sensual enjoyments and allows them to be accessible. But if you don't have a lot of money, if you don't have a lot of of comfort, then you have very little need to do that. What you have a need for is to feel anything other than misery.
Yeah.
And all the Democrats are going to be telling you and are telling you and will tell you in the future is no. You have to feel bad about any pleasure you have in life, whether it's going to Thanksgiving or having a cigarette or having a full sugared soda or going hunting. You have to feel bad about it or not do it and then feel bad about not doing it. And if you don't have comfort, if you don't have material comfort and ease and you're haunted by precarity, or like a real felt precarity, then the appeal of that denial is non-existent.
So basically, if you're a well-off, like blue state MSNBC watcher, you just got to go to ritualistic confession.
Mm-hmm.
Bless me, Father, for I have a granite top table, and
exactly,
because I have privilege.
Read 4 pages from Between the World and Me. watch Rachel Maddow, give some money to John Ossoff, and it's okay.
You can go
to Mallorca. You can go to Mallorca, right, and not feel bad about it.
Right, and also make sure you read a couple pages at least of Robin DiAngelo.
Oh, of course.
Yeah.
That's hardcore, though. That's if you really did something bad.
Yeah, that's if you really want to do the work.
Well, actually, I'd say Robert DiAngelo more is if you're aware that you could get fired. Like, because that's like the Robert DiAngelo thing is really how to avoid getting fired. Like, that should be the name of the book.
Yeah.
How to work in a nervous, professional milieu without ending up in front of human resources.
Yeah, that's true. We should
and if
go.
You don't, if you're one of these liberals who doesn't work in an office and who has like detach themselves from that kind of precarity, then you don't really need Robin DiAngelo.
Yeah.
You can stick with some Tennessee Coates.
Yeah. So I'm modifying my suggestion. So go with Ta-Nehisi Coates if you are engaged in one lifestyle employment situation, and then DiAngelo for another one. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Matt.
If you want to hold on to your cubicle.
Yes, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. It's a cubicle retention guide, actually. Do you think you could, in like 1 minute, convince Taibbi to be a socialist or Marxist?
Sorry.
I'll just put it this way. We know where everything's headed. We know. It doesn't matter if the Republicans win the election or the Democrats win the election, or we beat the Chinese or the Chinese beat us, or there's we have a leverage buyout by the Chinese or whatever. The future holds. It's a neo-techno-feudalism until all the resources are gone. The only alternative to that is the boring shit that Marx talked about 150 years ago. Working people organizing at their place of alienation and exploitation, sharing the common experience of alienation and exploitation, applying it to the problem of making their lives of dignity and plenty, and then getting numbers sufficient to confront power.
Boom. There you go. Cut to the Internationale.
Yeah. Okay. That sounds great. Yeah. I'll get right on.
Yeah. Let's all just do that.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, well, I mean, the problem with it, though, is that from the practical percentage of people who right now have to do things like, you know, be journalists or be media figures or talk about stuff, well, what does that have to do with the price of butter? And it really doesn't. We are trapped in this discursive bubble, and unless we're going to break out of it, you know, we're going to go Unabomber, or we're going to try to like go back to the people like the Narodniks. You've got to disinvest emotionally from the idea that you're really doing anything. And then that void, that emotional void that's left where you're not getting, you know, a sense of satisfaction or completion or actualization from the job of being a media figure, you got to put something else there. But that question of what it is a personal question. It can't be prescribed by anyone else.
Yeah. So will the Biden era be more or less funny and interesting from a commentary point of view than the Trump era?
Oh, I think Biden's going to be hilarious.
You think?
The fact that he broke his foot saying he was playing with the dog, and then 2 days later, like,
he was sucking
shower,
off.
Sucking off the dog. The fact that he's not even...
He was sucking off the dog in the shower.
He's not even inaugurated, and they're already doing Weekend at Bernie stuff to act like he's not a mummy. And then you have... And then I think, honestly, the thing that'll make it funnier, especially from the perspective of Chapo, and the thing that we were looking forward to with Hillary is that as funny as Trump was, and he was hilarious and still is and always will be, the humor of talking about Trump's funny stuff is undercut by the fact that you have an entire media apparatus just sweating their balls off trying to make fun of him too, to delegitimize him and talk about how unnormal he is and be horrified by it. Whereas that entire apparatus will now be committed to trying to tell you, no, he's not a dying mummy.
Right.
And that will make it his dying mumminess way funnier than Trump's
was. Right. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And right. And also it makes our role much more useful.
Well, I don't know how useful
I should say we don't have to worry about, this is a mistaken way of viewing the world, but we don't have to worry about sharing those talking points.
Yes. MSNBC. That's one of the things that makes it funny is that you're liberated.
Yeah, exactly.
You're liberated from it. Like the specter that haunted media commentary during Trump was the orange mad bad, orange mad bad thing, you know? Because are you just at a certain level, you are just contributing to this flow of banal liberal commentary, which is just going to, you're already seeing it completely dry up. And it's amazing. Like there is now this alternative media space and it'll be very interesting to see how it develops, because you're not seeing any kind of realization that, the reality of austerity and COVID and misery under Biden is going to be different, and that it's going to require a different approach to power than your reflexive Democrat worshiping. But everyone's fully committed at this point. They have sold their souls. And beyond that, they're fully bubbled with one another to the point that they're not even aware of how absurd and out of touch they seem. So the ground is going to be very fertile, and I'm looking forward to it.
If you had to bet on any pundit to break ranks and be the first person to pick on Biden.
Oh, man. Jake no one Taffer. On MSNBC. No one who has a show, that's for sure.
Yeah,
they're all absolutely in the tank. I don't know. It'll be interesting. I honestly think they might not, that we might see fewer than you'd assume, just because, as I said, like the social pressure won't exist because, like in everything, this is disconnected.
What if he keeps breaking bones from sucking off animals and he ends up like, they're rolling him out.
A full mummy, yeah.
He's got casts everywhere and attraction. I mean,
they've already figured out a way to say that it's ableist to make fun of him just like fritzing out like a 50s robot. They'll find out a way to say that that is somehow ableist or racist or whatever.
Anti-Irish.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, Black Irish. If he's Black Irish, he's going to use that a lot.
All right, excellent, Matt. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Yeah, this is great.
Where can everybody find your work?
Podcast Chapo Trap House. Also Chapo Trap House on Twitch, the channel. That's where I do my streams. Also, they go on YouTube at our Chapo Trap House YouTube page. That's it.
And at Kush Bomb.
Right? At Kush Bomb. Yes.
Kush Bomb on Twitter. Yeah.
All right. Thanks so much, Matt.
Thank you so much.
Excellent. We'll check in again soon.
Yes.
Bye-bye.
That was great.
That was great.
Learned a lot. Had a lot of fun talking with him. He's great. He's funny. He's smart. He's gotten kind of increasingly vulnerable, by the way, over the years, which is nice.
Vulnerable? What do you mean?
Yeah. He talks about on his vlog, he talks a lot about feelings and despair in a way. I mean, he's still hilarious and ironic, but that's definitely a space that, Chapo didn't, they do get serious, and it's very moving because they're like motivated by a sense of right. They have a real moral clarity, moral conviction, but he talks more about he's more open about his emotions than he used to be. We not really explored on this episode, but a little bit, but I also So yeah, everyone follow him. And I want to make sure that people know that the reason we're not giving a full review of Mandalorian is because Matt was so affected by not watching it that we just don't have time on this episode.
We don't have time to get into the breadth of emotions that I didn't feel.
Yeah, so we'll do that next week.
Yeah, excellent. Yeah. All right, thanks for tuning in and listening and or watching to Useful Idiots, and we will see you soon.